but I knew that it would be a tremendous blessing. I did want to start off today with a little fun, but I didn't want to distract too much because I'd be kind of like, it'd be an oxymoron distracting my own message about distraction. And so what I wanted to do, if you can just imagine this, I was going to grab my wife and say, hey, you know, call my phone while I'm up here teaching. And then my phone would ring, and y'all would hear my dumb ringtone from Twilight and all this stuff. And so I'm just kidding. That's what someone told me. It's from Twilight. No, it's not. It's an old component. Never mind. And so so I was going to say, hey, call me. That way I can get distracted, and it'll be a distraction. And anyway, and no, I thought, you know what? There's not enough time. There's time to be serious, and there's time to be funny and all that. And so today is about distractions, And I think it's really important that we look at this today and what the Bible is saying about this, because there is a lot of distractions happening in our world today. Of course, everyone knows what's going on in Israel, and everyone's seeing the outcome of that, right? And that can be quite distracting, though biblical, distracting nevertheless. People have been fighting this whole time, the last election, and whether you are Republican, whether you're a Democrat, whether you believe in abortion or whether you do not, and whether you are good with gender ideology and you're not, then there's so many things to get distracted of that pours in through what I like to call the Prince and Power of the World Network. I believe that every media, even conservative media, I believe that it has traces and laces of the enemy, the wicked one. Because what I find myself doing, if I listen to liberal media, I find myself getting grossed out because it's anti-God and I see all the anti-biblical stuff. But then when I swing the other way and I start completely conservative media, I see there's a temptation to want to get hateful. And I want to get hateful towards those who don't agree with my beliefs as a conservative. And so I'm saying, you know what? I'm going to dismiss that because that's a distraction. My eyes need not to be focused on my phone, the news, cable network television, whatever. My eyes need to be focused on Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. I'd mentioned Israel, and I've been, since it happened, and since I came back from sabbatical, I've been teaching at our ministry through Ezekiel 37, 38, and 39, and we actually completed it. And we did an in-depth teaching and comparison to today's events. And that got me pumped. It got me excited, just knowing that, man, it's really coming to a head. Now, I need to explain to you, up until that point, I was very distracted. Because beyond the things that you guys see socially, there's things happening in your own lives. It could be finances. We've had inflation. We've all been struggling one way or another to make ends meet. You could be, you have lost a job. Maybe businesses have shut down. Maybe you are having kids trying to get into college and just it's just not working out. Maybe you have a child that's sick. Maybe you're sick. Maybe your parents are sick. Maybe you had to bury somebody. Maybe you had to do this or do that and lose things. And it can become such a great distraction. And you have faith in your heart. You have Christ in your heart. But sometimes it's hard to see your heart because your mind get so clouded. And I'm telling you, that's what happened to me. On September 15th, I had this vision about ministry, and I was thinking, you know what, I want to reach people that have issues mentally and struggle with, you know, these kinds of things. I want to have a group of people with suicidal awareness because I myself struggled with suicidal ideology for years of my life. I want to do this, I want to do that. And all it took was something so silly, but one more creditor to call me. That's all it took, one more creditor. And I broke. Because you have to understand, I get calls every day. And why? What led me to the situation? Well, beside being a pastor, I was an operating room coordinator at one of the local hospitals. Hey. I worked along top surgeons, top heart surgeons of our nation. And then all of a sudden, I start limping. Now, because of that job, I got a nice home, in Portland, Texas, in the suburb, really nice. And I got a car, and we got another car. We got kids going and finishing their education. And I thought, man, I'm a hospital coordinator. Good. And then all of a sudden, I start limping. My left knee goes, cartilage completely just decimated. Because when you're working in surgery, you walk about 10,000 steps a day, if not more. Or 10 miles, 20,000 steps. And my leg was just shot. So I'm there hopping around trying to do my thing. And HR says, no, you can't do this. You gotta go away, get it fixed. Happened in the middle of pandemic, 2021. So in order for them to sign the benefits of all the benefits, let's say the hospital gives you, you have to see a doctor. And doctor says, oh, I don't have anything available for 2 months. No income, family waiting, bills piling, house getting behind. And since that happened, I went back. I did my 6 weeks out. Doctor finally saw me. And I said, send me back to work. I need to pay bills, bro. And doctor's like, okay, well, you go back. Your legs are not going to get better. But if you can find a job where you sit down, get off your leg, you might have a chance because you're still young. I said, I know I'm 25, doctor, but come on now. Well, I go back to work, and I've already been replaced. And, yeah, I was replaced by a 20-something-year-old. No offense, 20-something-year-olds. I love all of you. And they said, we know you served here 5 years, instrumental in saving many lives. We don't have a spot for you anymore. And I'm like, what am I going to do? My spirit says, trust the Lord. The Word of God says, trust God. My mind said, what are you going to do? Well, I lasted pretty long until September 15th, after many, many debt collectors, doing all this stuff with the house, trying to see how we can save it, and getting ready to let one of our vehicles go, and just the struggle at all. Then you have the health issues that come into your home, like my wife's health issues, ER visits, and then the rest, and you get overwhelmed with distraction from what is right. And what I say was right, God is right. His word is right, living and true. So September 15th, I went down. All it took was one creditor to call me. And I said, I'm done. I give up. I have nothing else to do, and I got nothing to offer, nothing to give. And I went down. And what happened after September 15th? October 7th happened. And in my soul, I knew that was monumental. In my soul, I knew, David, this is not the time to lay down. This isn't the time to stay in the dust. It's time to get up. Regardless of what you think you're losing, regardless of what you think the Lord has not given you, which was a lie, it's time to get up. By the grace of God, he got me up. And I want to share this with you today because in first service, there's plenty of people that came up afterwards and said, that's exactly what I'm going through. And it was such a dark thing to have a heart that sought after Christ and then have your mind get so clouded and deluded by buying and accepting the enemy's lies. And can a pastor fall into that? Yes. If I walked as a Christian for 20 years, can I fall into that? Yes. If I had been a Christian for 2 months? Yes. Guys, the enemy wants to kill, steal, and destroy, and he's seeking whom he may devour. He goes after the weak ones first, and eventually he'll go after the ones who are stronger, but I consider myself a weak one because I'm a man of flesh. But I want to tell you something, what helped me through his word, and I hope it helps someone today. First, I want to point you to, let's look at what the word has to say in Luke chapter 21, okay? The Gospel of Luke, chapter 21. No, I didn't bring my water up here. That's my water. And so, in Luke chapter 21, in the beginning, you have the widow and the two mites, thank you. And then, after the story of the widow and the two mites, you have his disciples and Jesus, what is known as the Olivet Discourse. I'm going to sum it up for the sake of time to get to where we're going today. So in the Olivet Discourse, Jesus and his disciples were there at the temple, and the disciples wanted to show Jesus, look how amazing this is. I mean, look, Jesus, look at the stones. Look at how they were hewn, you know, there's no tools. Look how they just lay on top of each other. Look at how beautiful white they are, and look at how when the sun hits them, it looks like this building's glowing. Jesus, look at Herod's temple. Look at this second temple. And Jesus just tells them, I assure you, there's going to be a day where not one stone will be left upon another in this temple, signaling a sign of the end, of a end. And so the disciples ask three questions. They ask, when is this going to happen? And what's the signs of the end? And when is the return of your coming? What do we look out for? So in the entire Olivet Discourse, from verse 5 all the way to 34, Jesus starts to tell them, in the end, there's going to be false prophets, false teachers. Watch out for that. They're going to arrest you. They're going to persecute you. They're going to put you in prison. There's going to be men's hearts failing from the anxieties of the things that they see in this world. There's going to be earthquakes in various places. There's going to be wars. There's going to be rumors of wars. Someone's going to say there's a Christ here and the Christ there, but don't go after him, Jesus says. He gives them this whole discourse about it. He talks about the abomination of desolation and the rise of the Antichrist and the Jews running to Petra when he does the abomination of desolation. And he talks about these things. And finally, where we're at today, this is what he says. But take heed in verse 34. To yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and the cares of this life, and that day come upon you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. There was something he mentioned in verse 34. You know, Jesus is truth. As he stood in Pilate asked, what is truth? Little did he know that truth was in his face. But Jesus is the truth. Jesus is the way, and Jesus is the life. So he says in his truth, take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and the cares of this life. Jesus wasn't talking to the tax collectors and the sinners here. He wasn't talking to the wine bibber. He was talking to his disciples. Who asked him the question? His disciples. Disciples means pupils. And he says, take heed that your heart, disciples, oh, you heart, you follower of Christ, you who pick up the cross and follow me, take heed that your hearts do not get weighed down by those things. Carousing, drunkenness, and the cares of this life. Carousing would be more of the thrill of life, you know, going against what God's word says, just to get that thrill, just to get that fill, just to, you know, the flesh, the three-pronged method of the flesh. Jesus, the Lord speaking through John in his epistle, John chapter 2, that the cares to love the world is the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And that all comes in with carousing, the things that feel good that you know that don't ride with God, that aren't good with God. Why would Christians do that? Because of deception, and I'm going to tell you that in a minute. Then he says, drunkenness. Now, I've been a Christian for quite a while, and I've listened to all the arguments. I've been at the most legalistic churches to where, man, you don't even get a non-alcoholic drink or you're going to hell, you know? And then I've been to churches that are very licentious, where, dude, let's serve margaritas tonight, you know? And I've heard all the arguments. Well, Jesus turned water into wine. Well, it wasn't the wine that we have. Oh, yeah, it is. Or no, it's not. For what? Point is, drunkenness is the lack of being sober. And whatever, there are many Christians today that struggle with this. Whether it is alcohol, marijuana, pill popping, whatever. And I'm not one to talk because I struggled with addiction. I know what it's like. I know what it's like to yield to the flesh and let that be a stumbling block in my life. So Jesus is saying, don't let your hearts get weighed down with this stuff. All the thrill, the seeking, the living against the word, drunkenness, and the one that I recently had succumbed to, the cares of this life. Like I said, a lot of us fight with each other because we want to argue about what political party we stand for. We fight over issues of our day and in our homes. In our homes, we fight in our marriages. Children fight against parents, parents against children. It's the cares of this life. And what is it all? It's a distraction. A distraction from what? Keeping our eyes on Jesus Christ, which is the only thing that matters. The only thing that matters in our life. I want to read to you what Genesis chapter 3 says in verse 1. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, pay attention, listen to this. Verse 1, 3:1. He said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? That's the enemy's first thing, guys. That's his first attack on your mind. Did God really say? Let's backtrack a little bit. Did God really say you can't get drunk? Did God really say you can't drink? Did God really say that you can't smoke marijuana? And you've all heard this one. He grew it, right? Did God really say you can't go to bed before marriage with someone else? Did God really say? Did God really say that you can't be, you know, just constantly? And what does it do for us that don't know the Word of God or choose to not go to it when it comes to issues in our life? What does it do? It makes us compromise. It makes us compromise. It makes us go with our flesh instead of what God. And I've heard many Christians say, but my heart, God knows my heart. My heart is leading me to this. And you're right, because Jeremiah says that your heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it? It feels right in my heart. This is what I stand for. Apply the Word of God, contrast your heart to what the Word of God says, and you'll find the truth there. See, repentance is changing our mind, saying, God, I am wrong. You are right. I agree with you, according to your holy word, that you are right. I'm wrong. You're good. I'm not. And you saved me. You sent Jesus Christ to die for me and rescue me from the darkness. Did God really say? You know, that's what the enemy told me back in September 15th, and the whole process of messing my leg up and the rest. He said, if God is so good and you're a minister of his word, why are you in such a rut? Doesn't God's word say that Jesus even said that I will give you life and life more abundantly? Where's the abundance of yours? Did God really say? See how he is? And you go and serve the Lord, and you know you're pleased in serving the Lord, and then here comes the enemy with his tricks and his shenanigans. Marriages get divided. He gets in the middle of relationships, and it's always with, now, you see what you do for them, but they can't do that for you? I think it's time to find someone else. Well, the Bible says that I shouldn't, that I should be devoted, you know, for the rest of my life. Nah. Did God really say that? Come on. You deserve better than that. What about church? Church is funny, man. I've been a pastor for 17 years, going on 18, and it's funny. You talk about, you're here preaching the gospel, and then you have people just whining. They do, right? I'm like, I don't know, I have so many scars, man, it's crazy. But you go to church and they have something called church hurt, where people have been hurt through something, through someone. And the Bible says, honor your elders, and elders, love on your people as they serve the Lord. And then here comes the enemy. I didn't like the way that elder talked to me. Yeah, you're right. Don't put up with that. Did God really say you're supposed to honor him that way? But what about in your situation? That's a little bit different. Or the other way, if you're the elder and then they're biting you and hurting you and talking about you, and then you know that you shouldn't tell anyone because the Bible says that if you got a problem, handle with it one-on-one, but don't repeat a matter to someone else because that causes more division. But then the elder calls the other elder and say, hey man, can you believe they had the audacity to say this, to do that? And the enemy's like, yeah, tell him, man, because did God really say? Watch out with him. He's smart. But I want to share this ultimately with you. This is beautiful. There's many blessings of God really saying something, and he means it. And it's true. And it should inspire and motivate every one of us. For instance, in Proverbs 30, verse 5, every word of God is pure. He is a shield to those who put their trust in him. Did God really say that he's a shielding? Yes, God really said. And he's a shield. You know what I learned through my process? I don't want to talk about me that much, but I do it because of relevance. What I learned was, I thought I was the only one. I thought that God just, yeah, you know what? We're just going to go ahead and let Satan out on your life and, you know? And I'm the only one, and no one else got problems but me. There I was, self-focused. And like I said, I was teaching through Ezekiel 37, 38, 39, and I was listening to great, great commentators and doing some great, magnificent studies to get all the facts together. And I came across Chuck Missler, and Chuck Missler's great. I've been listening to him for years. And then as I read his bio, I come to realize in his biography, he was working as an aerospace engineer. He was making a lot of money. He had a house. He had cars. He had kids in school. And then they fired him. They fired him. He lost his house. He lost his cars. They went bankrupt. And he was man of God. And I'm thinking, dude, aerospace is way bigger than hospital coordinator, you know? And then he went into another house up somewhere, and there was an earthquake. And it gets swallowed into the ground. And I'm thinking, wow, and this guy still teaches and he still has faith? Yes. And I told my wife, you know what? What a blessing. All of us will struggle. All of us will go through something, but God is faithful because Chuck Missler has a house now. And I will have a house after we lose this one soon, you know? God is faithful. So you know what I decided to do? Instead of trying to hold on to it and hold on like cat, you know, scratching the carpet, I tried all that. I just let it go. I let it go. I called my creditors. I did debt consolidation. I did, you know what? You want the house? You can have it. You want the car? You can have it. I cannot let these things get between me and God. Amen. I cannot let these things get my eyes off of Christ. Because off of Christ, you have nothing but hopelessness, despair, depression. But if you keep your eyes on Christ, the whole world can fall off all around you, and you're still going to be all right. Because he loves you, and there's power in his blood, and he promises to take care of you, never leave you, never forsake you. That's what he said. And biblical prophecy is God's signature that he's real. So when the bones collected there in Ezekiel 37, God said, this is my people Israel. After 1900 years, after 70 AD, when that building went down, like Jesus said and predicted, and not one stone was left upon another, in 70 AD, the Jews spread out all over the world. And then you saw what happened with Nazi Germany. They wanted to extinguish them. And then they come back into the land, May 14th, 1948. And what happens after that? They get attacked by the surrounding countries. Then what happens after that? They win in 6 days. And then just a few years later, 5 years later, Yom Kippur, 1967. Jerusalem's divided in half. Half of it belongs to Transjordan. Half belongs to the Jews. The Syria attacks. Jordan attacks, and it's called the War of Yom Kippur. Israel defeats them in 25 days. And it was written in Ezekiel 37 and 38. But the big one's coming. Ezekiel 38 and 39. And it says, Magog, which is Russia, along with Iran, along with Syria, Turkey, Lebanon, Sudan, they're going to attack Israel. And that the hand of God itself will be against them and destroy them. Five out of every six of Israel's enemies on the mountains, the Golan Heights, northern Israel on the border of Syria. Let me tell you why that's exciting. Because God said it was going to happen, and it did. We got the mountains in 1948. They didn't have the mountains. It wasn't until 1967 that they got possession of the Golan Heights. God said it was going to happen. And then just in recent articles, they're all weighing in. Iran by proxy. Russia made a statement last week that Israel's doing breaking international laws of humanity. And it's all, for me, it's like Bible prophecy. Now, I appreciate those that say I stand with Israel. But when you read and study Ezekiel 37, 38 through 9, God's allowing this because they don't recognize him as God. And continuously through those chapters, he keeps saying this over and over, I don't do this for your sake, O Israel. He says, I do this for my name's sake, that the world will magnify me in my name and realize that I'm God. Why? Because the world's forgotten about God. The world doesn't believe in God. But he's going to show this. It's going to come to pass. And if all that came to pass already in 1948, 1967, then guess what? His whole word is true. And if his word is true, then his promises are true. And that I'm never going to leave you nor forsake you. That he will love us. He loves us. He came to find us. And if we get lost, he'll find us again. He loves us. That he sent his son to die for us. That we don't have to worry about our works to get into heaven. It's by his righteousness. Jesus Christ died on the cross so that we can gain access. When we meet the Father, he's not going to say, so how many Girl Scout cookies did you buy? I just need to make sure you're good. How many ladies did you walk across the street? How many people did you get food for? How many times did you witness about me? You think, no. Nothing we can do. Our righteousness, our greatest righteous acts are like filthy rags before the Lord. The one thing that we must do is accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, because it is by his blood and his righteousness that we enter the kingdom of God. He's not going to see you. He's not going to see your sin. He's not going to see your failure, which the devil loves to remind you of. No, he's going to see the blood of his son, if you've indeed made it into the kingdom of God. If you indeed believed in him, I'm sorry, you will make it into the kingdom of God. Now, did God really say, well, the devil's a liar. He loves to lie. Jesus said this in John 8, 44. You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your heart you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there's no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. So it's easy for us to be deceived. Because what consists in a lie? A lie can be 99.9% truth. And all it needs is just that little fraction of a lie, and it becomes a lie. Now, because the enemy is challenging our whole world, and you've seen it yourself, you've seen it, where they're like, you try to say, well, the Bible says, we don't care about the Bible. As a matter of fact, I know that the Bible was mistranslated and through hundreds of years, blah, 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 blah. You know, they do that. They do that to attack the integrity of the Word of God, but the Word of God prevails nevertheless. Nevertheless, and because the Bible is true, the wicked deny it. I want you to turn into Psalm chapter 10, if you would, here really quickly. And I'll begin reading it for the sake of time. Why do you stand afar off, O Lord? Why do you hide in times of trouble? The wicked in his pride persecutes the poor. Let them be caught in the plots which they have devised, for the wicked boast of his heart's desire. He blesses the greedy and renounces the Lord. The wicked in his proud countenance does not seek God. God is in none of his thoughts. His ways are always prospering. Your judgments are far above, out of his sight. As for the enemies, he sneers at them. He said in his heart, I shall not be moved. I shall never be in adversity. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit and oppression. Under his tongue is trouble and iniquity. He sits in the lurking places of the villages. In the secret places, he murders the innocent. His eyes are secretly fixed on the helpless. He lies in wait secretly as a lion in his den. He lies in wait to catch the poor. He catches the poor when he draws him to his net. He crouches, he lies low, that the helpless may fall by his strength. He has said in his heart, God has forgotten. He hides his face, he will never see. Arise, O Lord. O God, lift up your hand. Do not forget the humble. Why do the wicked renounce God? He has said in his heart, you will not require an account. But you have seen, for you observe the truth in grief to repay it by your hand. The helpless commits himself to you. You're the helper of the fatherless. Break the arm of the wicked and the evil man. Seek out his wickedness until you find none. The Lord is king forever and ever. The nations have perished out of his land. Lord, you have heard the desire of the humble. You will prepare their heart. You will cause your ear to hear, to do justice to the fatherless and the oppressed, that the man of the earth may oppress no more. What we see today is wickedness, and the wicked deny the word. And the reason why they are so easily convinced is because they're not aware of Satan's devices. They think it's just natural. 2 Corinthians 2:11 says, lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. And I'm telling you what his devices are today. The main one is, did God really say? Your answer, yes. The word of God says this. And stand on the word, regardless of what the culture tells you. 2 Corinthians 11:3. But I fear lest somehow as a serpent deceive thee by his craftiness, so your minds may be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. Satan, like Jesus said, there will be many false teachers. Don't be deceived. They make Christ complicated. It's not complicated. He died for your sins, and you go to heaven through him. That simple. That simple. Don't get into all these weird things, guys. You know, by the Spirit of God, what is the truth. And then verse 14, and no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. That means Satan can come across very holy and godly, but he's not. Did you know that it was an angel, a beautiful angel, in fact, that around 600 AD visited the prophet Muhammad? Beautiful angel. And this angel gave the prophet the words to the Quran. And the prophet he was illiterate. He didn't know how to read or write. So he had his servants write it on everything that they can find. Tablets, leaves, everything. But it was a beautiful angel, according to the testimony of the prophet, that gave him the letters of that book. And in the 19th century, another angel appeared, beautiful, magnificent, and met a man by the name of Joseph Smith. And they gave Joseph Smith the book, the extra testament of Jesus Christ. And how easily, in both of those, particularly religions, people bought into all that. But I can tell you, our Bible, the Word of God, it says, do not add to my book, or I will add to you the plagues of the book. And do not take away from my book, for I will take away your name from the book of life. So the Bible ends, and that's everything that God had to say. It's the Word of God. Ephesians chapter 6, 11 and 12, this is what it says about combating. It says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Remember, guys, that our fight is not with each other. That's also a big distraction. We fight against opposing political parties. We fight against everything. And God never called us to fight. What did he call us to do? He called us to love. He called us to love. And if we're fighting, then how is that Christ? It's not Christ. It's the flesh. And you know what it is? A distraction. People will stop going to hear the word of God because they were offended by somebody. Or they're not. Or they're going to first service, so now they're going to go to second service because the other person's there. What do you leave with? Do you leave with, man, that was a good word. Man, the Holy Spirit was really ministering to me this morning. Or do you leave with, I'm so glad I didn't see them. They're in second service. You know? Think about all these things. We don't fight against, we don't wrestle against flesh and power. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. Our spiritual warfare, our weapons of warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty in God in pulling down strongholds. We have to keep our eyes focused on Jesus. As a matter of fact, in Revelation 12, 9 through 11, it says, so the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with them. Then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of God, our God, and the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our brethren, who accused them before our God day and night, has been cast down. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. That is focus on Christ. Because your accuser, that word devil in Latin is diabolos, which is accuser. So what he does, he sneaks in your life, causes you to get distracted. No, he's like, look over here. You're looking at God, you're reading the Bible. No, look over here, look. This person's talking about you. Or this person's doing that, or this is happening. Look at your job, you're going to lose it. Look at your car, look at your house, look at your kids. They're turning against the Lord. Look. There he is, pulling you away. And then when he gets your attention, because one of those things will strike you. You love your kids? My kids. You love your job? My job. You love your house? My house. One of those things. He'll keep going until there it is. I found it. And he just starts railing on you. And when he finally gets you to get your eyes off of Jesus, and you end up messing up, because you will fall. A righteous man may fall 7 times, but he will get up every single time. If you fall, get up. Don't stay down. Get up. Some people call it backsliding. I like to call it fall. Trip and fall. The enemy tripped us up. Once he gets you tripped up and you commit that temptation to sin, whatever it is, disbelief, whatever, then he goes to God and says, you see? They don't deserve heaven. Look, he's doubting you. Well, he has your word in front of you, but look, you threw something at him and all of a sudden he's doubting you. You see? And that's what Revelation 13 just said. He's the accuser of the brethren. But we can overcome him by what? The blood of the Lamb. Remember, it's not our righteousness we enter everlasting life, but his righteousness. What else? The word of his testimony. Keep on giving the word of God. Keep on proclaiming Christ in your life. And finally, what was the last thing that he said there? We didn't love our lives to the death. I'm fine. Take it. Take the house. Take the job. Take it. Like I said earlier, take everything that would take me away from the Lord. Because he's worth it, isn't he? He's worth it. Who in here never worries about anything? Is there anyone in here that's mastered that ancient samurai skill? Okay, good. We're all in the same boat. This is the trickery of anxiety and what will help you. Luke 8:14, now the ones that fell among the thorns are those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked with cares, riches, and pleasures of life and bring no fruit to maturity. That's Luke 8:14. Matthew 13:22, for you note takers, you can write this down if you'd like. Now he who received the seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. So The cares of this life lead to anxiety, lead to worry. In my case, I was losing material things and I got my eyes off of Jesus. But then I had to realize Jesus is bigger than my little world. And I'll tell you what, Jesus has taken care of many people in the past, and he's taken care of me in the past. In my own life, Jesus has done so much for me. What makes me think he's going to fail me now? What makes me think he's going to fail me now? He's never failed me before. He loves me just the same. And yet there's a whole world out there of people that are hurting. There's a whole world out there of people that are lost. It's not time for me to hold on to material things, the things that are going to burn anyway. There's nothing in this world. I don't want to lose my soul over gaining this entire world. And the sad thing is, a lot of people lose their souls over losing things in the world. But I don't want to gain the whole world and lose my soul. And it's not worth it. Jesus is worth it because he laid it all down for me. And I love him. I love my Jesus. And I know that he'll always take care of me. And if he can take care of me, he'll take care of you. And he has been very faithful to all of us. If we have our eyes on him, we can see it. If we don't, we won't see it. But we need to keep our eyes on him. Philippians 4:6 says, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." Don't be anxious for stuff. It's okay. Don't worry too much. You're going to give yourself a heart attack or a stroke. And I know, I worked in a medical place. The people that were anxious, worried, freaked out, man, their blood pressure was high. You're going to destroy your kidneys. You're going to go to dialysis. You're going to suffer some severe problems because of worry and distress. But if we put our eyes on Jesus Christ, he says to cast all our cares upon him because he cares for us. Now let's look at the trickery of fleshly living, and we're getting ready to close. I told you about what Jesus had said there. Be watchful, because there's going to be a time. Then he said, make sure your hearts aren't weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and the cares of this life. We covered the cares of this life. But let's look out for fleshly living, the carousing, if you would. In Hebrews chapter 12:15, it says, "Look carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled." I believe there's a lot of Christians that have bitterness in their heart towards their own families or towards their own husbands or wives or even towards their own brothers in Christ. But the Hebrew author says, be careful lest you begin to plant a root of bitterness. In other words, don't focus on whatever the offense was, but focus on Jesus Christ and let it go. Let it go. Hosea 4:11 says, "Harlotry, wine, and new wine enslave the heart." I never knew that until this morning. I actually read that. Going around sexual morality, and remember, because the devil's like, did God really say that it's wrong? Go with your heart, man. He's a liar. Going around, that's harlotry also. Being drunk, having a great time, all that, it just brings your heart into bondage. And when I would come off of my highs or I would come off of my drunkenness, I never felt good. I never felt good about it. I actually felt worse of myself. So just toying around with that substances, guys, as a Christian, don't. It's not worth it. God didn't give us that anymore. Just like with anxiety, he did not give us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. Well, he didn't give us substances to escape. Our escape is him. Our escape is him. Romans 13:11-13, "And do this knowing that the time is, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and in drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, and not in strife and envy." Paul summed it up right there. 1 Thessalonians 5, 6 through 8, therefore let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. And finally, in conclusion, this is the importance of watching. This is the importance of watching and be ready. 1 Peter 4, 3 to 7 says, for we have spent enough of our past lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles, the sinners, when we walked in lewdness, lust, drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, and abominable idolatries. In regard to these, they think it strange that you do not run with them in the same flood of dissipation, speaking evil of you. But they will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this reason, the gospel was preached also to those who are dead. They might be judged according to the men in the flesh, but live according to God in the spirit. But the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious and watchful in your prayers. Jesus said in Mark 13, 35 to 37, watch therefore, for you do not know when the master of the house is coming, in the evening, at midnight, at the crowing of the rooster, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly he will find you sleeping. And I say to you, I say to all, watch. Watch. 1 Thessalonians 5, did I read that one already? 5, 2 to 4, for you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon him, as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that day may overtake you as a thief. And again, the day of the Lord in 2 Peter 3:10, but that day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works are in it will be burned up. Therefore, beloved, look forward to these things and be diligent and be found in him, peace without spot and blameless. Did it get brighter in here, or did the lights go out? It's like, for a minute there, I thought the Lord was actually coming to get me. It got so bright up here. Guys, I just want to go ahead and conclude with this. Life does get overwhelming. It does get tough. It does get unbearable. You know, it gets hard, especially when you lose things and people that you love. When the marriages don't work out, when the kids become prodigals, it breaks your heart, man, because you love them, right? You're raising them up in the ways of the Lord. You took them to church. And that little guy right there is just looking at me. He's all good. But then they turn around and they start listening to the lies of the wicked one. All I can say to you is be steadfast. Be immovable. And if you fall, it's okay. Get back up. The Lord will lift you up. He knows you're not perfect. He knows what you're incapable of and capable of. But what you need to know is that he loves you. He loves you, and he will never leave you, and he will never forsake you. And he has a plan for every one of you. Every one of you. You don't have to be an evangelist. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to be a singer of a big, you know, worship team. God has a plan right where you are, and he has given you the opportunity to be here today. My prayer this morning was, Lord, please send the people that need to hear this message. A lot of you didn't even know I was going to be here. I didn't even know I was going to be here. It's a couple weeks ago. Well, one thing I do know, the times that I taught here many a times, I believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is coming very soon. And I believe that it would help all of us with whatever we're dealing with inside to get our eyes back on Christ. And that way, you ain't going to miss his return, and you will have so much peace letting go of this world that tries to distract you from the true and living God. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this day that you blessed us with, and I thank you for your word this morning. And Lord, if there is anyone here that was ministered to this message and they needed to hear this word from you this morning, I pray, if you're speaking to their heart, perhaps they found themselves falling down and not getting back up, or perhaps they've just never put their hope, trust in you, and they want to do that this morning. Just where they're at, Father, I pray. All heads bowed, eyes closed. If you need to get back up, you've walked with the Lord in the past, but you've found yourself so distant, but you know that he never left you or forsook you. You know that he's good and he loves you, and you want to get over that, whatever it is that's keeping you from him. I pray that you raise your hands right where you're at, that I may pray for you. Anybody in this room, anybody, God bless you. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you, Father. If there's been anyone in here that has never made a commitment to Jesus Christ, maybe this is one of your first times in church, but it has stirred your heart and your spirit, and you, from this moment forward, want to commit yourselves to him, I pray that you raise your hands with all heads bowed, eyes closed, that I would pray for you. Anybody in here? Thank you, Lord. Father, I just ask that you bless the folks that are here. Let, like Maddie said, let this message permeate within them throughout the week. Let them keep their eyes on Jesus. Let me keep my eyes on Jesus. And thank you for lifting me up when I go down. I pray that you lift those that fall down, lift them up as well, Father, because I believe you are coming soon. And we ought to live watching and waiting and praying that we be counted worthy to escape the things that are going to take place. Father, we love you and we praise you. And we give you all the honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.